Warm welcome, Beijer Electronics transformation story. So thank you to Beijer for sharing your transformation story. This is going to be very exciting and hopefully a great learning experience for all of you. And so thanks to Axel, Charlotte, Nidzara, and Festim for putting together this presentation and sharing your story around the changes that you've made over the last couple of years in terms of how you view product development, how you collaborate in product development. So I'm going to stop sharing my screen and hand over the mic to Beijer. So a warm welcome. The floor is yours. And thanks again for sharing your story.
So let's, the first test here is to see if we can share the right thing, wrong thing now.
We can see your screen.
Not the right now.
Perfect.
Okay. I will skip the agenda just to take a brief look at it, but get into it immediately. Warm welcome to you all. We are super happy to have you here and that you're interested in our search for a better way to do product development. My name is Nidzara Dellien, and I joined Beijer 3 years ago. And I came from a completely different industry, and coming to Beijer meant for me that I had to change. It was super new. Scary. I understood I will have to learn a lot of things, but as I come from a long experience of working with software development, 20 plus years, and R&D at Beijer was mostly software people, 70%. So I thought maybe I would have something to add to the company, even though I did not know the automation industry, which is very different from everything else that I have done so far. So I came in and I was very prepared to do some hard work, a lot of hard work. And how much hard work it was going to be, I understood in the first PI planning that we had in March of 2020. And for you who don't know, PI planning, it's a safe event, 3-day event. It's big room planning where you spend first day on going back to the past quarter and taking a look at what have you promised to do, planned to do, and what you actually achieved. And then you spend 2 days to look forward. What are we going to do in the coming quarter? And of course, the first day we are there, it's a big room full of people. And of course, coming from software development, I did not expect that everything would be delivered as planned. It seldom is. But as the day went, I got more and more discouraged about what I was hearing. And it was not so much the content that was presented on the how did it go, but how we chose to present the content and how we talked. And what happened was that we had, I think, 6 teams at the time, and every Scrum team has one product owner, and product owner will go up. And the product owner will show a list of features or bugs, and they were phrased in the terms of like it was a number, like Jira number or TFS number, and then it was a very technical name, and then there was a lot of red. And PO would say it's not done, it's spillover to next. And there was not much of an explanation why. And there was not much sense that this person standing and presenting the team's work was failing and succeeding together with the team. And this just continued. And the team was sitting in the room, very silent. No sense that they actually belong together. For me, I could not even figure out which team, because I was very new, which team was part of which slides. And it was super tense. And in the end of the day, it was just felt like a very long day of just telling stuff that we haven't done and telling it in a sense that they didn't do it. And there was a very big divide between product owners and their teams. And then I realized that yes, there will be a lot of hard work, and it will be the other type of hard work than I was waiting for when I came. That was one of my first things that I experienced 1 month in that really shook me up. So that's me.
Yeah, my name is Charlotte Grane. I'm the head of product management HMI in Beijer Electronics. So that is mainly consisting of the biggest product line that we develop ourselves. And the content that is planned for in these big events then cater for what's to be developed mainly on the HMI area going forward. And I think I share the impression that Nidzara had. I joined 1 year earlier than Nidzara. I've been in the company since the beginning of 2019. And my first impression when I came here was that it was a very strange atmosphere. And there was very strange dialogue between product management and R&D. And I come from other industries as well. I don't have the automation background, but I come from product development companies where there have been some quarrels. There is always some kind of tension, which there should be as well, between the product organization and the R&D. But this was at another level. And I tried to highlight it as well, but it felt like it was in the walls in a way. You couldn't really change it easily. And I think when new people were joining, it became more and more apparent that something needed to be done. And it was not just the mindset, it was actually how you do things that needed to be changed in order to break that atmosphere and the silos that we were in. So that was my take when I first joined Beijer. I'm happy that we all got to experience the journey that we have been in since then.
Hi, everybody. My name is Festim Zuta, and I'm the UX designer here at Beijer Electronics. And I joined almost 2 years ago here at Beijer Electronics. Before Beijer Electronics, I was 10 years at Apple, and then joining Beijer Electronics was a big difference when it comes to coming from a company that is very, very customer focused and very working in a product discovery way. And then I actually joined while we just started this journey and transforming over the customer journey. And it's all about the customers. I joined exactly on right time, should I say. But of course, there is challenges. And this is what I love about Beijer Electronics. And then we are here to always improve and become better at what we do and come closer to our customers and make the best products in the world. So that's me.
Thank you, Festim. So my name is Axel Gustafson, Vice President of Product. I've been with the company longer than all of you together in a variety of different roles. I'm a member of the management team. So I've been here 16 years. And today we are going to talk about our journey. We will focus the journey sort of in recent times, so at the end of our SAFe journey and the beginning and where we are in our empowered product teams journey. But we need to start at the very beginning. So back in 2017, we decided that we need to implement a scaled agile framework because we wanted to become more agile as a company. That decision was taken and we started implementation. And at the time, there were lots of excitement. Finally, we were going to have full insight in what we're doing, when we're doing it. We will know what all the teams are doing. We're going to have fantastic synchronization and the pace of innovation and pace forward is going to improve. So we had our first PI planning in January 2018. At the time, I was a product owner, was very excited. We started, and as you start something new, you will learn, and hopefully you will come better. But what we found over the years, sort of every single PI planning, every quarter, instead of becoming better, faster, more agile, sort of the mood in the room became worse. spillovers increased, commitment decreased. So we weren't becoming better, we were becoming worse. So we took the decision to let's do something completely different. And it's sort of this completely different journey that we're going to talk about today. And you can see the rest of the timeline in this period from when we took the decision of empowered product teams until today is the focus of the rest of the presentation. But first, I think let's have some context. What do we do? What type of business are we in? What kind of company are we? We create solutions for customers in a variety of different industries. Energy production, manufacturing plants, water, wastewater, marine, building automation, transportation, infrastructure. To make these industries, the companies in these industries, more efficient, more effective, to accomplish more with less. And we're doing that by automation. So we're developing products, both hardware, but predominantly software, that help our customers automate machines, automate processes, become more efficient and become more effective. And we have been doing this since 1981, so we've been in the market for quite some time. Size-wise, we are approximately 1 billion SEK in sales. We are a fully B2B business, so we only deal with other companies. And we have roughly 3,000 customers globally. We are a completely functional organization where we have three sales regions, one product organization, one supply chain organization, and one R&D organization. We do development in three different locations, Sweden, Taiwan, and Germany. And Sweden is the biggest development organization. It is also in Sweden where we will focus the presentation today and the transformation journey. R&D, as Nidzara said, about 70% is working in software. Globally, 80, 85, 90 people in approximately 9 teams. So that's sort of the size of our organization.
Today.
Yeah. And so here in Sweden, as Charlotte said, we are developing HMIs. HMIs are the screens that are on machines used in factories and infrastructure. We produce the hardware, develop the hardware, but the biggest investment we do is in the software, the IX HMI software, which is a drag and drop no code tool to develop your visual identity of your machine. And it's also where you build all the functionality and all the logic in how you interact and how you get the machine to do what it's supposed to do. And that is the beginning, the context. And with that, it's time for a question. We want to know where you are today. And if everything works correctly, you should be able to scan this QR code and give some insights on where you are and what you are using today as your development methodology. Let's see if this works.
Exciting. We didn't test it.
We have tested it.
Have we tested it?
Yes. We will see if it works.
I've sent an answer at least.
Yeah, that's good. that's the first part of this working.
We need to refresh.
No, it should come automatically.
Okay, but maybe while we are waiting for the technology to work, maybe someone can tell us just few like shout some words at us what they're using today.
no methodology is also okay to say.
How long did we wait?
No, it doesn't seem
to work.
Okay,
so we will just assume that you are doing some of these at least.
Max is writing empowered product teams.
Nice.
In the chat. Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, and where I am at in the Lego group, we are also trying to do empowered product teams, and they can decide how they work. So they do all kinds of stuff from Kanban to Scrum to something in between.
Thank you, Preben. And then Martin is writing Scrum-ish and other approaches. Andreas, safe-ish. Uwe, safe. So people are writing in the chat.
Okay. But then since some people are working or have been working with safe, you're familiar with this nice picture. And I will not linger on this, but for you who don't know it, it stands for Scaling Agile Framework. And I think it came about maybe 10 to 13 years ago, I'm not completely sure, to answer the need of aligning a number of agile teams, because at that point you could see that Scrum or Agile was working really nice for the teams, but then what happens when you want to align number of these teams into one coherent, together moving organization? As you know, as you see, this becomes very complex very fast. And one of my reflections was that when I came from a much bigger company, and I realized that we were doing safe in 2020 here, I was not really understanding why would we need such a big machinery for such a small organization. Mm-hmm. So let's not spend any time on this, but we can talk a little bit about what it meant for us in our organization in March of 2020. So we, at the time, we had a program team that was catering for 6 Scrum teams. So this was the organization. And what happened, program team was consisting of product managers, system architect, and UX designer. And their job was to do some kind of product discovery, which often meant that they would talk to the custom product managers, would talk to the customers, talk to our salespeople, figure out what features need to be implemented. And then system architect would do some kind of technical feasibility. Is it possible to do? And then we would, if there was any UI, there would be some UI sketches. And then this would be put into a backlog. And then these backlogs were presented to the Scrum teams. And of course, Scrum teams would then pick up the features and develop them. And product owners were in the teams, working with them daily, with different amount of success. But only just having someone who is creating a feature and someone who is developing a feature is already there. You are creating a sense of us and them. And this setup comes with different problems. So one being the context for the team. There was lack of context because team could take a feature without really knowing what problem this feature is to solve and what who are we solving it. I think also the problem was that typically in these teams, you would have people who have been in the company for many years, know the product, know the market, but their take or their ideas that could have improved the solution never came up, never became visible because they were already presented with a feature that to be implemented. So they were not part of the discovery. And if we are to be honest, we were at the time not doing much of a discovery. What we did was we would go to customers, end users, we will write up features, we will do some feasibility on different levels. And then we didn't go back and say, will this solve a problem? But what we did, we put it in a backlog. It, when it was prioritized, I have spilled over a couple of times from different PIs. Mm-hmm. It will come out. And then if we were lucky, it was solving someone's problem. But that was not always a given. So this is where we are at, one aspect of it. And I think Charlotte will tell you a little bit more about it.
Yeah, so that brought us into the challenges that we were facing at the time. And what Nidzara just described, that was the planning sessions for these features. We did that in a PI planning session. And what you see in the picture here is a result from a PI planning session. So two organizations, product and R&D organizations, spent two days to create post-it notes and these lines that connect to different activities during 2 days. And in the end, there was not high confidence in the organization that we actually would reach the goals and be able to deliver on the post-it notes on these boards. There were also numerous issues with the actual planning as such. So the wording was more, the focus was more on the wording on the post-it notes than on the value that it was creating for our customers. The customers, they weren't really mentally in the room. They were considered sometimes as obstacles for us to do what we wanted to do, not seen as someone that could give insights to us of how to create the best products in the market. Also, it was difficult to prioritize all these tasks. There were unknown sizes because the teams had not been involved in understanding what we should accomplish. And they also resulted in a battle between features and architectural updates, as well as the technical depth and the maintenance that you need to do on a software product overall. And also the features were always highest prioritized because we had customers come in with requests, and it was at the time we were really sales focused organization. The strategy was less important. It was important to sell our products. And I think that you all know from different areas that if a customer comes in with a big opportunity, it's difficult to look away. You need to talk to the customer. Then it's easy to also have these features as the most important ones in the end of a planning session. So finally, in the end of the period where we were supposed to deliver on this board, nothing was really delivered as we would have thought it would be, and resulting in many customers that were unhappy with the situation because they didn't get what they were promised. The sales organization had lost trust in the product organization because they had the relationship with the customer as well. And also, since these features were not delivered, it was not good for the development teams as well. And it was not their fault. They had not been part of creating the feature backlog and was not part of the discovery that would enable them to do a good job, actually. And also, there were not much maintenance fixed during the PR as well. So customers with issues in our product stayed with these issues for a long time without us being able to resolve them. It all ended up in a big blame game within the organization. But a few of us in the team came over a book called Inspired, and this was in the fall of 2020. So it was approximately half a year since you joined Jara. We're a few of us read the book and we became very inspired by the book. So the book is written by Marty Kagan at the Silicon Valley Product Group, and it describes a new way of how to structure and staff a product organization and how to discover and to deliver products that our customers love and that actually works for the business. And all the stories in the book made us very interested in if we could have this kind of setup in our organization as well. So how could we create the value that was described in the book for our customers? Would this even be possible? So could we have an inspirational environment instead of an environment that was actually draining us sometimes? So during the spring, when we had read a book and discussed it a while, we started to think of what we needed to do and how it should be done to implement what was described in the book. And in June, we took the decision that this is something that we want to try out in our organization. It couldn't get worse, right? So what was the first change that we did? One of the biggest changes that was described in the book was the creation of one team, one product team. So instead of having product management and design and architect outside of the team, we actually created one team where all these functions were involved. So that means that there is a product architect, a product manager, and a UX designer and the developers within one team. So they can all work on the risk in a solution and work on the discovery before delivering on the solution and such. And looking back, if we would have done this earlier, I think that there are many choices that we could have done differently looking back at this today if we would have done the proper product discovery. And so one other thing that was really obvious that we should focus on is to focus on the problems to solve and not a list of features to deliver on. So we started on the problems to solve, and we started talking about more outcome and not output related issues. And this also resulted that we needed to talk about objectives and key results in the end of a planning session, instead of having a feature output measures. So just before the summer in 2021, we communicated a plan to the organization that we're gonna start to work with product teams instead of the SAFe methodology. So the next PI would be the last PI doing in the SAFe way, and instead moving on to the OKR, objective and key result planning, as was the next step. So we started up with one team that started as a product team, so that we could clear out all the problems that we could experience during the first planning session, and then roll out the same methodology to the other teams. So in October, we started up the first team as a product team during 2021, and then we rolled to be able to roll it out to the rest of the organization. And we also needed some methodology to strengthen the team in how to do this work in the best way possible. And this is how we came in contact with CRISP. And we had a few product managers that were attending the product discovery training at CRISP. Though there was still one piece of the puzzle that was missing. And this was a really important piece of the puzzle in order to do a proper product discovery. And this piece in the puzzle was Festim.
Oh, thank you. And as Lotta mentioned, I joined right there. And from me, I have a quote here. It's not my quote, but it says, if you want to create great products, you have to start by understanding the people who will use it. And that is very important. For me, for my role as a UX designer, I mean, I'm here to bridge the gap between user expectations and our digital solutions, to make sure that we create the best interfaces and experience that not only meet our customers' expectations, but exceed users' needs. So we want to, as Axel mentioned, we want to create products our customers love. There were some questions when I came to Beijer first I needed to answer, and what was like, who are our target customers or users? What problems or challenges are we trying to solve with our products? What are our business or project goals? And of course, do we have existing user data or research? Are we collecting data, telemetry from our software? Do we know our customers use our software? So that was very important for me to gather and really build up with data so we can make decisions when it comes to product discovery, or when we do our design sprints or we make next features, we have data. We can say, this is how our customers use our product. And product discovery is a huge part of what we we do it today. And our goal is to always work in this way. So problem discovery, you start with a problem. And we call this the double diamond. So you start with the discover part. And to discover part, you first learn about the problem by gathering information and talking to people, doing customer interviews, stakeholder interviews, sending out surveys, requesting for feedback, and really observing how the customers. The second part of the discovery part is to define, to clearly state the problem you want to solve based on what we learned. And when we know, okay, this is what the problem is, then we have the problem defined, then we go to the next double diamond, the D, it's develop part. Here we start up coming with a lot of ideas. We ideate, we do brainstorming, and we come up with solutions. And the last step is, of course, to deliver, validate. So really try out those solutions, the prototyping, to make sure that what we try to solve is really working with end customers and our stakeholders. And this double diamond, you have to go back and forth. So you go back. So it's not just one way, but it goes like this. And it's really amazing how easy and how good it was. So the key is to repeat the steps, going back and forth until you have a great solution to the problem. And we also, while we do this, we have the risks in mind. So we have, of course, the value risk, whether the customers will purchase or use the product, the usability risk, can they use it? Do the customers understand how to use the product? Feasibility, do we have the capability in the company? Can we build it in time? Do we have the right skills? Do we have the technology? And of course, business viability risk, which is whether the proposed solution aspects of the business, is this what we have in our business?
May I say one
thing? Yes, of course.
Just to clarify why this is important, is at this point we have written zero code.
Yeah.
This is all conversations, UX prototypes, validating the ideas. So we haven't really engaged in writing the code yet. Because if it turns out a bad idea, we haven't invested too much.
Exactly. So you don't have to spend million and million of Swedish crowns or dollars to invest in a project and then realizing we have the best product in the world, but our customers and our end users don't understand how to use it or don't solve any problems or don't see the value in the product. And it's a waste of time. That's why it's really important that we do the product discovery. And while doing product discovery, we also did a design sprint. And a design sprint is something that comes from Google Ventures, and it's used by Apple, Google, Facebook, all the big, Netflix, Tesla. So this is if I can explain in a short way, it's a fast way of doing the product discovery. So it's a 5-day workshop, and you have certain roles doing certain things. So we have one who is the decider. Usually it's a VP or a senior VP or someone who can make a decision in the company. We have the business, someone who represents the business, PM or someone from marketing is always there. The creator can be a UX designer or a UI or someone who is good at designing or creating. And we have the builder, either an architect or a developer or someone who understands the programming bit. And we also have someone who represents the customer, someone from sales or it can even be from marketing too. And of course, a facilitator. And in this case, we had Marcus, who joined us and was the facilitator in our design sprints. And we've done more than one design sprint, but this is just an idea. And we do design sprints when we want to have, for example, when we want to come up with a new product and see if there's a market fit or if this solves our customers' needs. And a design sprint, as I said, is a 5-day process. So you lock together these people. You don't have to lock them, but you put them in the same room and really have a great workshop. So the first day, it's all about who are the users? What are their needs? What is the context? What problem do they have? We look at competitors, we talk to stakeholders, we interview customers. So the first day, it's everything about it. We just gather information and really try to understand the problem. The second day, we start sketching. We ideate, we envision, develop service solutions and say, okay, this is what we think. On day three, we decide. When we decide, we vote what is the best idea, and then we start storyboarding. And on day four, we start prototyping. And this is done, in our case, in Figma, which is very low code. And the important thing about the prototype is not making it beautiful. In our case, we managed to do both beautiful and and usability, but it's not, the main goal is not spending hours and hours to make it look good, but it's really focus on usability. Is it easy to use? Do your customers understand? And on day five, validating. I mean, try out now. Go back to the first day when we talk to the stakeholders and say, you had this problem, or this is the problem we think that this is the solution we think will solve your problem. Is this something you can consider to buy or use? And we let them test the final prototype. And as Nidzara mentioned, this is very low code. It takes 5 days, and we can see if this product needs to go further or we need to change to another direction.
Because we are testing an idea and trying to reduce the risks of viability and usability.
Yes. And in Beijer Electronics, the customer is in focus. We have a big, big focus on customer centricity. And customer centricity means making customer the top priority in all aspects of business. We try to understanding their needs, providing excellent service, and building long-term relationships. So it is really important for us that it comes from the customers and then we work outside.
And also to maybe just to compare to what we didn't do in the beginning was that now, for example, we try to take, when you're doing research with the customers, we try to take people from the team to participate in the, so for one of our OKRs in the beginning was that every person in the team should have seat in a conversation with a customer during one of periods so that they get closer.
I think it's really important that all the developers and all the team really understands our products and really knows what we're developing and really knows how to use our product, because it starts within us. If we are not the biggest promoter of our products, then it's hard for us or sales to promote them otherwise. So I really think it's important for us to have the team joining the sessions while I'm doing interviews or while someone else is doing interview. We have PM and the rest of the team also joining and observing and see how our customers use our products. I think that is a key aspect in product discovery.
And this also is a big change versus what I described during the PI planning, where we saw the customer as an obstacle. That is definitely not the case any longer. People are interested in asking questions of how our customers actually are using our products. So this is a big change in mindset as well overall in the organization.
Definitely. And then we have our next question. Let's see if this time it will pop up. So what are your biggest challenges today? So today, I think if you just write something, it should pop up a list of words here. But of course, if it doesn't pop up, then we have Marcus who is waiting for the chat there. And hopefully we can try to answer some of them.
Let's see if we can get a word cloud going here. Google Cloud is that?
Yeah, Marcus. SoundCloud.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I submitted a response. So it seems like it's not popping up. I suggest you could write in the chat. And in as a response to the question that you see on the screen as well, and I'll shout them out as I see them.
Do you recognize what that in the challenges that we have described now? Do you have similar challenges in your organizations?
Exactly. It would be great if you could highlight that, everybody in the audience. While we wait for responses, I think one of the biggest challenges is lack of direction. So lack of direction in terms of vision and strategy. That is something that we see at CRISP. Mm-hmm. That's a big challenge because it's an upstream thing that trickles downstream. We get a response from Michael. It is difficult to get higher management to buy into the process. Michael, do you mind explaining a bit more what you mean?
Yeah, sure. We are working, I would say, with Kanban and also with Scrum, and we're trying to do safe. But from higher management, it is a lot of just get things done. And why should you define a new problem? We know what we want to do. And yeah, it's hard to get them to buy in, and also it's hard to get them to buy into not having a one-year plan with defined set dates when we are delivering things.
Yeah, it's a mindset shift. Beijer, yeah. Do you have a comment on this?
Well, I think for us, convincing management, which was partly me, wasn't very difficult because what we had wasn't working. So basically, trying something new wasn't really a big risk for anybody. It couldn't get much, much worse. It could only get better.
We need to get worse first.
No, I don't think you need to get worse, hopefully. But I think to a certain degree, you need to feel the pain before you can see that something can be really much better.
A recommendation.
You can ask them to call me and I can explain.
A recommendation is to put or to share the data. So are people engaged? Are they happy at work? If they're not happy, let's look at that data. And are you shipping things? Are you shipping value to customers? How long does it take to go from A to Z? To start measuring these things. And a good practice is a value stream map where you show from, you know, the process, the steps that you take in order to bring value to customers. Does it take 9 months? Does it take 2 years? Does it take 2 weeks? I don't know. But just to highlight and to make things tangible on what goes on in product development. That's a tip to think about. We got some other interesting responses in the chat, so I'll bring up. Senior leadership expecting a change but not changing themselves. Ooh, that's a classic one. Any reflections from Beijer?
I would say like this: we were lucky that we have not a very hierarchical organization, mm-hmm. And we were also lucky that we stumbled upon this book, several of us at the same time. So I think we were reading the book independently of each other. And then kind of came to each other and said, oh, I read this book. And it was like, yeah, I did that too. So there was a little bit of luck and a little bit of that when management, so this basically came from the managers in the organization. And it was propagated down. And the only up was to our CEO. And he was definitely buying it. Yes. So.
And we were lucky to have we're a mid-sized company. So, and not as hierarchic as Nidzara mentioned. So since Axel was part of the team and part of the management team, it was not, we didn't have that kind of obstacles to implement it. And we don't have so many teams as well. So it's not a super complex thing to do for us, and we needed to have a change. So
we were leading the change, and thus we were behaving in the way we wanted others to behave as well. So we didn't have that problem. We had other problems.
Yes.
Another comment from the chat: listening to our customers and users instead of saying that we already know what they want. Mm-hmm. Smiley face.
That's a good comment.
Yeah.
Good. So let's get going.
there will be more time for questions in the end.
Yes. So where are we today? Everything is not, like we say in Sweden, guld och gröna skogar, or everything is not perfect. What is hard for us? Going from objectives and transitioning to objectives and outcomes have been challenging. We were in the past very used to describing what to deliver, not really describing the impact it would yield, and getting the full organization all the way down to the engineers to transition from releasing a release to achieving a result has been difficult. We also have an internal challenge, and that is that we have a big project, a big replatforming project, which we're doing, which takes a lot of our resources and has a long lead time, which means that the feedback loop from actual customers using our product, the new product, the thing that we are developing in the real world, is very limited. We're also we are shipping a desktop product and devices which run that software. And they are very much not connected to anything. So we get very little quantitative data. So building KPIs becomes very much a proxy exercise. And the teams, and with the teams, I say the product teams, the leadership teams, we struggled now and again, on sort of, oh, how do we do this? Well, now we have this problem. And this is where Chris has been very good at helping us and coaching us and being a very good sounding board for those ideas, those challenges. But we are in a much better spot now than we were just a few years ago. It goes back to one thing which we need to talk about, that is planning. Why do we plan? I think this is a key point when it comes to getting alignment up in the organization. The planning becomes very much important because that is the touch point to management and us. Why do we plan? Why we plan today is to get everybody aligned on where we need to go, not where we, or not how to get there. And in the past, it was very much the opposite. We planned how to get somewhere, but we didn't really explain where to go. And that is not a very good way to plan ahead. So we went from PA planning to OKR alignment. The OKRs are very much owned and done in each of the teams before the alignment. So they own their own destiny. The focus is on expected results, not features. This is not always easy, but we try always to come back to what are the results, what are the outcomes you will get by solving this problem. The sync between the teams happens naturally before the alignment in the teams, which is very important. And all the team members now talk about we. We are doing something together, whereas in the past, as Charlotte described, it was much more we and them. And at the end, we went from 3 days where everybody was exhausted in the PI planning, needed a vacation for a week, to 1 day full with energy, where I feel that most people have more energy at the end of the day than at the beginning of the day. And that's really what you want to accomplish.
So it's a little, we were getting close to the end of the presentation, and a little recap. And it's what is better now? We just had a session last week. It was very energizing, I would say. What we do actually is in the beginning, we had in SAFE, you have a person, a role called RTE, Release Train Engineer, engineer, that is organizing all of this. But when we moved over to product team setup, we decided that it would be the management who organizes this, because we wanted to show that this is something we really stand behind, and to show the way how to do it. So we pair up and we rotate. So last time it was Charlotte and Christopher, the time before it was me and Niklas, and next time it would be Axel and Tobias. So we pair up and we organize this day, and try to, between every of these sessions, alignments, we gather data on the input, we get all the input we can and try to. So I don't think we've done twice the same way. It's not the big changes, it is stabilizing, but it is
iterative.
Yeah.
It is getting better. So what are the things that are getting better? So we don't get as many surprises when teams are presenting, because it's seldomly that you get into, are they doing that? We are not going to support that API for in 5 months. That doesn't happen as often. There is much, much more focus on product discovery, as we spoke about, and people are interested in customers and customers, what's going on in their heads. Again, alignment. We both see it in the presentations that they would match. Content-wise, they would match. If this team needs that from that team, it would be on their slide. But we also follow up, as I said, and we see that we follow up with the question, how has this day helped you clarify the path, where we are going to? And we see that that number is rising for every time. We are quite high, like we are 8.2 of 10, I think. For 60 attendance, I think that's quite a good number. We talk outcomes as much as we can, and if we can't, we at least point out it's not another. We really try to come to an outcome here, but right now it's just this feature we need to get done. So you kind of, even if you don't manage it, you almost ask for forgiveness a little bit. And we have a lot more demos. For every time we do it, there is more demos. They are not the same. The teams do it in different ways. And what you see here, this guy, the smiling guy, he's our best tester. His name is Eddie. And why he's smiling is that he has his hands on a prototype that another team has prepared for a demo. And he's trying to break it. And he did. It's a demo. It's not super... super, you know, quality-wise, super good, but he was so happy to have.
And one of the things we see with this day is also that these days used to be so heavy with information, very technical, savvy, and not everyone was following what the other teams were doing, and it was not motivating and interesting enough. But what we've seen now, when we change to OKRs, it's more inspiring, it's more motivating, and as Nidzara mentioned, we understand what the other teams are doing and the other teams aren't. So I am really
putting together a puzzle of the big whole.
Yeah, we're not talking how to code in this one, but we are showing demos. And I think that is really important to motivate the team and really get them to see the big picture of where we are going, as Axel mentioned.
And a good example of this is our head of HR has been with the company for quite some time. And he sometimes attended PI plannings, and they always came to me afterwards and said, "But I don't understand. What is it that we're gonna do?" And when he attended the first OKR session, he said, "Now I understand what we're gonna do and what we're gonna accomplish." And that was a nice touch.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's not the most technical person.
Yeah, we also try to limit the presentations, so the time for each presentation. We limit the time so that we force the presenters to keep it on a high level. Otherwise, if you know something very well, it's very easy to get down into the details. So now we force everyone to keep it on a high level so everyone in the room understands and get more as an alignment, not a detailed discussion.
And then another thing, so what is better now? So what you're looking at, this is a still picture of a video where the management team, PM management team and R&D management team, people that had very difficult time talking to each other 3 years ago, are doing, we are dancing Jerusalem. It's a flash mob. So we prepared the flash mob. Some of us were better than others, and some of us were not there because they had some important other stuff to do.
Yes.
But we actually started the music, and then we just started to dance in front of the whole of the team.
And some of the team members came up as
exactly.
Who knew the dance as well.
So we are having more fun. It's definitely a day that's different and energizing. And often we go and grab a beer afterwards. And of course, we could have left it here. That like, so we went from misery to this amazing place where we're always just happy and hold hands all the time. But it's not like that, of course. And there are so many challenges still to solve. We have some legacy issues where we have a very strong architect, system architect that has been everywhere, and we are really trying to empower our product team, product architects that are in the team. So this is ongoing process. So it's like a parent that doesn't really trust that their kids have any judgment. So we are trying to get him to relax a little bit and let it go. We are struggling with measuring outcome, as Axel said, putting a KPI that you will know something about first in the end of next year is not so easy to put objectives to, but we are doing what we can. And in general, I think it's very difficult for engineers or most of us to go to objective from being very concrete. We end up like in solution mode. We are into the solutions immediately, but struggling to stay in the what do we want to achieve, and then how we achieve it is a different question. These are some of the things that we brought up. Do you have anything else you think comes to mind?
No, I think that you mentioned the biggest tackles, especially as Axel mentioned, we are in a big project where it's quite clear what we need to do to accomplish a project, that since we also work in a hardware development. So to be able to focus more on objectives is hard, especially hard in this context. But we decided that we need to try it out anyways, and it's better to try it out now so that we have a mindset shift, and then when we can focus more on new development than other type of development, then we are already in this mindset. So then we can create much better products for our customers.
And another thing is that this sounds really nice, but of course we discuss things. There is always this slight tension between what PMs want and what R&D can achieve. But the tone of voice is completely different now. Very respectful to each other, and it is, even though that we come from different views, it's very clear that we are solving the problem together. And that's I think for me the biggest change that has happened over these years, because before we were fighting, and we were fighting in a not a very constructive way. And now when we fight, it still has a purpose, or not fight, but when we discuss. So that was what we were going to tell you. So now it's open for questions. Maybe we should just let go of the slides so we can see people.
And I unfortunately need to go. We're having a strategy meeting just next door here, and I need to run back to that. But if there are questions which my colleagues cannot answer, which I can answer, I will write the answers. I'm guessing, Marcus, you can distribute them somehow.
Absolutely. Thanks, Axel, and good luck. Let's do some Q&A then. So I'm going to open up Slido. And hold on one second. Okay, so you can go to slido.com and enter the hashtag Beijer and pose your question.
Yeah, better luck with your tools than us.
Yeah, let's see. Let's see. Hopefully they didn't jinx that. And while we wait, I'm going to pull up the chat because we had some interesting chatter before. Let's see. How often do you update, revisit the OKRs? A question from Max.
So we used to have the PI planning quarterly. And then we experienced that we spend a lot of time on the planning and some of the quarters are more productive than others. So some of the quarters that happens over the summer, you don't actually have so much time with it where all the teams are present, so you can do much of development. So after a while, we actually changed to tertiaries as well. It's much more difficult to say, but I think it's more efficient for us. I think still the summer is considered quite tricky to manage, especially in Sweden, where all people have vacation at the same time. For me, I think going from quarters to tertiaries have been much better.
So every 4 months.
That means every 4 months, instead of every 3 months. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Thanks for that. We get a question on the screen. So how did you manage people change since the core team and SAFE will lose mandate, or maybe more correct, the overall responsibility? So when you do this transition from SAFE to an empowered product teams model.
Maybe I can speak a little bit to that. That connects to our remaining challenges, which is letting the system architect go. This is a person who is super knowledgeable and has had the full responsibility in the SAFE setup in this program team. And now he really needs to kind of try to let the product specific stuff, the product teams and the things that are relevant for the system to stay there. And it's a journey. People don't change because you have a PowerPoint, and they don't change because they say yes to something standing on a PowerPoint, but this is two steps ahead, one step back, taking step to the left, putting it back. It's quite a lot of work. And also I think what we're trying to do is we say that we will try, and we know that we will, at even to the best of our intentions, we will sometimes fail. And when we do, we will recognize it, and then we will like adjust back to the path that we want to be on. But some people have actually left because the role didn't suit them anymore. Some, we found new colleagues that are better fitted for the role. So we had to do some things, but all in all, I think this went quite good.
Yeah.
Very, actually, maybe a few people just, we had to rearrange a little bit. But
yeah.
I don't know if that answers the question.
And we also want to go from like a team that is overlooking everyone, from a team, each product team, that you have the power in the team, and that the program team, the overarching team, should be more supportive in that area. So more like guiding and maybe adding non-functional requirements so that we do things in the right way instead.
Yeah, and I think that's
Great. So pick a question.
Any change, you would have people who would change without problems, and then you would have people who would struggle with it a little bit. I think this is good to know, that not everyone will come to the same place at the same time, but there would be, it's work.
Yeah.
Yeah. Feel free to grab a question that you see on the screen.
I think that one is for Axel with SAFE. Why go safe with 19s?
Okay. Yeah, that's we were not there at this point in time. But I think you mentioned that in the start as well, that before that we didn't have a good methodology at all. And then as with the product teams, someone found SAFe and thought that that was a good way of working, and they tried it out. No, and they ending up going another place in the end.
How did you manage people change?
No, that was the one that we talked.
Any findings, learnings, reflections regarding OKRs? Yeah. From us, it is still difficult. I don't think that we have really found the key in how to do it. I think it's good. We start after a while, we started off giving the maybe a little bit too much responsibilities to the teams. I think now we have realized that we need to provide guidance for the teams so that they it's easier for each team to define the OKRs. So last year we defined yearly objectives. So as input for each planning session or for each planning with each team prior the alignment, you have planning within the team, and then you have these yearly objectives as guidance. So then you could, as a team, see which of these yearly objectives refer to us as a team, and how should we focus the next coming 4 months to be able for the organization to achieve on these yearly objectives. What do we need to do in this period of time? And I think this has been a big change. It's not easier for the teams to find which path they should focus on.
But the essence, our problem, so my insight was, if you cannot put the proper KPI, then it is very difficult to put up a good objective or key result. And we have one team that's working on a cloud piece, and they had been able to put a very number of users, time down of the service down, and then they were connecting their objectives to these KPIs. And I also have a team that is working on DevOps stuff with a CI/CD pipeline, and there we can say we want to build time to go from, I don't know, this to that, that there is something you can measure. But for the biggest part of organization, it was about move this functionality from this platform to this platform, and then this new product will hit the market in the middle of next year. So how, and then we try to figure out some things that are maybe not value for the business but value for us to move in the right directions. For example, everyone in the team has started to work on the new product, everyone in the team has met a customer, and we kind of trying to, because meeting customer was raising the awareness, going over to the starting to work on the new product was actually adding people into the mass of the people into the new project as we need to do. So we had to play with some things, but it's hard if you don't have a good KPI proxy for what you're trying to measure. And we talk, so this is a super big topic in our, I think every management team is that we are talking about, how do we measure success? Mm-hmm. It's like, we're coming back to that all the time because we don't really have good proxies for it really yet. Mm-hmm. And we laugh about how we phrase ourselves many times. We go back and like, what the hell were we thinking here? Mm-hmm. What was this supposed to achieve? So we're trying to be humorous about it.
I saw one question regarding that we're doing this change in Sweden and not globally. And I think, yeah, we do it basically mainly in Sweden and Germany. In Taiwan, we have another methodology of working. We're not that tightly coupled with that development organization. So it is a little bit limited. And it is actually one of the points that we have recently discussed, how to bring this way of thinking to all the other organizations except the product and R&D and more globally. So I think this is we have not come there yet. And I think in our context, since we have quite clear borderlines, it is possible to achieve, though we would like to have more the company work in this direction.
But see, this also as a discovery process. I mean, when we decided to do this, we didn't decide to go with everyone. We kind of started
some teams. Yeah,
we started one team almost under the radar.
Yeah,
to figure out will this work? Because if it doesn't work, we don't want to pull in like mm-hmm. everyone in it and then come, oh, it didn't work. So we I think we were running with one of the teams for 6 months just to kind of debug the biggest problems that we will have before even saying that we are. And this is a good trick for any change is that I often use is that if you want to change, you don't announce it like this crazy big, everything is changing. But you say, look, there is this idea. I think it will solve this problem if we do it this way. Let's test it. Let's test it for 6 months and then we evaluate. And it's much easier to people for people who are don't like to change. It's easier for them to commit to trying something out than to changing something forever.
And then the actual change will be much quicker and easier if you already tested
and
it out.
In 6 months, you will definitely find it will not be exactly the same thing that you said you would. It would be in essence the same and something will be a little bit different and then you work on that. Mm-hmm. So it's always a think of it as an experiment. Put the hypothesis, what you think will change, and then look for if you achieve this hypothesis. For me, this is the best way to introduce change in a company, in my team, in my kids as well.
Marcus, any question that you've, when you're scrolling through the questions, any question that you find this popular?
Yeah. Yes. I have one at the top. Consumers, roadmaps, and planned releases. How was that change for you? I assume the markets need something to be able to know what to sell, etc. So commitments
and whatnot. This is a tricky nut because also in this planning, we want to be as agile as possible and we want to focus on problems instead of features. So it was mentioned before as well that the customers and the rest of the organization want to know what we're going to deliver and when, because of course they also need to plan. They need to talk to our customers and they need to keep the dialogue open. Customers need to know what to expect in incoming product releases. And this is still a challenge for us, I would say. After a certain amount of time, when you have discussion with sales, they also understand that this they will never get a clear roadmap one year ahead. You need to understand that since they need to follow us along the way, you need to be clear with the communication along the way, and we are not always perfect on doing that as well. We're still having issues doing that, but as long as they get frequent updates and know where we are heading and what are the outcomes that we are foreseeing or hoping for having, then I think that conversation is easier to have without coming with a clear like roadmap with an exact timeline.
Okay, so I think that what we have, we can easily talk about what we are aiming to release. We have internal releases now on the path of this big product. So every 3 months. And the upcoming release, we are quite certain that everything that's on that backlog is going to happen. Next release after that, maybe 60%. It's a rolling wave, right? Certainty is better at closer. So what we are trying to learn, to teach the everyone around us is that this time horizon is a good, we know certainty is good. And then the next horizon, slightly, little bit, and then it fades out into more of a roadmap capabilities without much definition. But it's a learning process for everyone.
You want to grab another question? I have one for you if you want.
Go ahead.
Maybe it's the last question. So is product strategy the same as prioritizing problems for you, or is there a difference?
Is product strategy the same as prioritizing problems?
So the way I interpreted this, that product strategy is that, you know, problems to solve for the business, the strategic themes that you have, right? Maybe talk about the granularity on how you view problems to solve. right?
Yeah, it depends. Yeah, it depends on what level that you're talking about product strategy. So as Axel mentioned, we're actually in a new strategy work for the whole company, actually. So this is something that is ongoing at the moment. And of course, product strategy is first, you need to understand the customers. So I would say first, the customers and the segments to focus on are number one. And then when you know which customers and segments to focus on, then you can look at what problems do they have that is most important for them and that we can solve. And that sets the priority for you.
And then that can be answered, which of our products will solve what problem? Because it's not one project, it's not one product. We have multiple products. And some problems can be better solved with one product. So I would say that maybe for us, understanding what product will solve what customer segment problems is first step that we need to take, that we are just working on. As I said, currently we are replatforming, which means that we kind of know what we need to have, like when we get there in 1 year. So it's difficult to say. We are just trying to kind of get back, get to our customers what they already have, us, but better. So it's difficult to answer, but
yeah.
But I think currently problem question is more, is this product fitting better to solve that problem, or is this one, and not the product backlog per se?
Excellent.
Thank you for having us.
So I think you kind of touched upon most of the questions. This was so insightful, and to hear you know, the journey from A to Z, the steps you took, and what happened in what was the reality in the beginning and what has happened in the end. I think that was extremely valuable because you don't hear these stories. They're not very visible out there on the internet in terms of what we've learned through a journey like this. Right.
And this is also what the problem we had as well in the beginning, that we couldn't really find much information. There was not much. We couldn't find training, and we couldn't find good examples that you can actually touch upon. There is a lot of theory, but how to actually do it, it was really, really difficult. And this is also a reason to why we want to learn and try to be as transparent and open as possible in our journey.
Yes.
There was a question on management that just popped. What was that?
Yeah, let me pull it up. Maybe it was relating to change management methodology in your transformation. Why not? Change. Right, but you kind of talked about change management in terms of hypotheses.
It was not changing the management.
No, change management. Changing management.
The system goes with the servant leadership. It's distributed. Yeah. It's not a lot of hierarchy. We are mostly coaching on all levels. Not so much distributed, telling people. But this for Sweden is very natural.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You're an inspiration, and thank you for sharing your story. And let's give Beijer Electronics, so Nidzara, Charlotte, and Festim a warm round of applause.
Thank you for joining us, giving us good questions.
Yes, so enjoy the rest of your day. And if you have questions, reach out to Beijer and continue the dialogue. And see you soon.
Thank you.
Thank you, Marcus.
Thank you. Bye-bye.